Thank you, everyone, for attending the IEEE Power and Energy Society webinar series entitled A Condensed History of IEEE and PES. My name is Latoya Gordon. I am with the Power and Energy Society Education and Meetings team. And our presenter for today is Robert Dent. He's the chair of the PES History Committee. And I'm going to turn the presentation over to him, and we can begin.
Okay, fine. Thanks, Latoya. I put together this presentation because I thought there'd be some interest in finding out how PES actually got started, how its name has somewhat evolved, and hopefully this webinar will provide all viewers with some various level of previous information that they didn't know about IEEE and PES. So here we have the present logo of the IEEE, which we'll talk a little bit about a little later. So in the early 1880s, communications was actually the first important electrical technology. In fact, you could actually say that the telegraph and people using the telegraph had actually been very much accomplished, as well as it would be called a mature industry at that time. And, of course, communications we think of as Alexander Graham Bell, where the first patent for the telephone was issued by the U.S. Patent Office in 1876. Anyway, after communications was well established and was actually fully mature, a new industry came along, which was called the electric power and light industry. And it was basically started with some very important people, Thomas Alva Edison. And actually, Thomas Alva Edison, it was on September 4th of 1882 that Edison switched on his Pearl Street generating station, which was located in Lower Manhattan, and distributed power to approximately 59 customers at 110 volts DC direct current. Well, what happened is in late 1884, there was scheduled in the fall at Philadelphia an international electrical exhibit, hopefully for all American as well as all outside of North American people would come in and would exhibit whatever wares they wanted to show as well as to sell. Well, at the same time, there was a man called Nathan S. Keith, who was a consultant located in the Philadelphia area. He was actually a trained physicist, but he was also an inventor, had a lot of interest in electrical engineering. He distributed a proposal to interested parties for an American National Society, and the proposal was supported by many, and an initial meeting was held at the headquarters in New York City of the American Society of Civil Engineers on April 15th, 1884. So what was Mr. Keith's motivation behind it? And his idea was that, hey, we're having an international exposition here in the U.S., and wouldn't it be appropriate if we, in American electrical engineers, greeted all of the foreign dignitaries that came in to show their wares? And he thought there should be an American Electrical Engineering Society that would have that as its purpose. So after the initial meeting and the initial onslaught of interest, a second organizing meeting was held about a month later, and a slate of officers was presented, and it was voted upon. They chose Dr. Norvin Green, president of Western Union Telegraph Company, as its first president. Alexander Graham Bell, who had invented the telephone and was awarded in 1876, was one of the vice presidents that was elected. Professor Charles Robert Cross, who was chairman of the physics department at MIT and founder of MIT's first electrical engineering course, was also elected a vice president. Thomas Alva Edison, the inventor extraordinaire, I would call, was a vice president. George Hamilton, he was what they called an electrician. I think there was some confusion between electrician or some interchangeability between electrician and electrical engineer, and he worked for Western Union Telegraph. Charles Haskins worked also at Western Electric Company in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Frank Pope, who was a well-known telegrapher, was elected a vice president here and became the second president of the AIEEE. Also, Nathaniel Keith was made the secretary, and R.R. Hazard was made the treasurer, and Mr. Hazard was president of the Graham Company, which was a generator manufacturer at that time. I wanted to spend a little time on Frank Pope, because Frank Pope was kind of an adventurer, an explorer. He was a telegrapher, and he was somebody who also was very much involved with electrical engineering. And unfortunately, what I wanted to tell you about it, even though he was as smart and as knowledgeable as he was, Franklin Pope was actually killed by electricity. He had gotten back to Massachusetts, Barrington, Great Barrington, Massachusetts, where he was renovating the family home, and he had done a lot of renovations, brought in electricity, brought in all the modern conveniences. However, on a Sunday night, during a heavy rainstorm with strong winds, the residents of the city reported flashing wet branches had hit the power lines. With the lights dimmed in his home, Pope went down to his basement to inspect the converters and his meter. The wind had blown open the basement door, allowing rain to dampen the basement floor and the converters, which were mounted 2 feet away from the window. Pope reached up and closed the window. When pulling his hand away from it, the back of his hand made contact with either the converter and or a tap splice that connected the distribution line to converters. So Frank Pope at that time was probably 54, and he didn't survive that injury that he had. Another man I wanted to do a little bit more on is this Nathaniel Keith, because Nathaniel Keith was an interesting guy who I got a letter that I saw that he had written in 1921, where he basically is taking credit for what he had done. He says, "In thinking over my connection with the Institute from its inception by me in the spring of 1884, my labors in getting together with the 200 or more charter members, and of the continuous attention and work I gave to it during the several months of that year." This letter that he had written in 1921, of course, was already some 36, 7 years after the formation of the AIEEE, and Mr. Keith was somewhere around 82, I think he was going to turn 83 that year, was asking for some relief from his dues, since his investments had not done so well and his investments in mining stocks weren't throwing off the dividends that he had become accustomed to. But as soon as he would be able to get more work, he'd be able then to send in the money for his dues after that. So in 1884, the American Institute of Electrical Engineers was formed. There was a notice given, first president, Norvin Green, and of course they were ready for the International Electrical Exhibition. So this is what was happening in the United States of America. And there was similar excitement, though, around the world about electricity and its uses, and how so many appliances could be used in the house in order to make the drudgery of housework a lot easier. Business could also use it. Lighting was also very popular, which wasn't as readily available as it previously was. Now you could have street lights and you could have a lot of signs for businesses. But actually the first organization that was founded was the IEEE, the Institute of Electrical Engineers, which is a London, England-based institute. It was founded in 1871, a full 13 years before the AIEEE. VDE, which is the German Electrical Engineering Society, was founded in 1893. The Japanese Electrical Engineering Organization was founded in 1888. And IEC, the International Electrotechnical Commission, in 1903. SIGRA, 1921 and the Chinese Society of Electrical Engineers in 1934. Now, in order to now, once you had a profession, you had to start to think about what are you going to do in your profession. Obviously, there were standards, there were meetings, there were going to be transactions, articles, but you also had to have people learned in that area of electrical engineering. So MIT actually started the first EE program in 1882 in the physics department. Shortly, there were dozens of independent departments and universities across the country, and young engineers typically began their careers with university educations. Curricula were generally heavily oriented towards power engineering, and AIEEE established the grade of student member, and in 1993 authorized the formation of campus-based student branches. So the IEEE serves this profession, and as you can see the AIEEE badge, you can see its first standard, a committee report, as well as the code of conduct for AIEEE. So through standards and the code of ethics, local sections, technical conferences, and publications, AIEEE served its members and their growing profession. The first action in the standards area was the adoption of the name Henry for the practical unit of induction in 1890. So here we come to what is the emblem or the badge of the AIEEE. The badge was produced that contained the Franklin kite as the badge shape, a Wheatstone bridge on the parameter, a galvanometer representing magnetism and induction, and a compass needle. Above the compass is the name AIEE, and Ohm's law is listed there. C is equal to E over R. Well, it wasn't more than maybe about 5 years, and the original badge was replaced by the design shown here, and the replacement had a modified kite outline, the letters AIEEE, and two linked circles demonstrating the intrinsic interaction of electricity and magnetism. So the AIEEE structure, it was basically founded in 1884 and operated essentially out of New York. The first two sections that were established, one in 1802 in Chicago, Illinois, and in Ithaca, New York. And in 1903, the first non-American section was formed in Toronto. And actually, since everything was operated out of New York, the New York section was actually not formed until 1913. Because you might have thought the first section was going to be in New York City where the AIEEE was founded. But I think AIEEE was so energetic in that area that they didn't see a need for a section until 1913. In 1891, standardization was started by forming a committee on units and standards. And the first technical committee in the AIEEE was formed in 1903 and was named the High Voltage Transmission Committee. Now, during that period of time, there was also the birth of radio. And radio was a new, different technology than power engineers were somewhat used to. And there were some institutes that were formed. One was called the Wireless Institute. There was also another institute that was actually a company institute where the engineers in their company could talk about radio and its applications and maybe its design and how it could be improved. And eventually that institute was opened up to other employees of other companies, but none of them really had a further going on beyond the initial start of their organizations. So when they finally decided to form a committee that would start the IRE, it was radio was a new technology. And my first question, what I would think of is, gee, wouldn't you really have thought that the radio people would want to get involved with the American Institute of Electrical Engineers, because they all studied similar programs in college, they all were electrical engineers. But what I understand is that there was not a warm welcome made to IRE people initially when AIEEE was approached by them. So what happened, of course, is the IRE got started, and it started in 1912, and it was devoted to radio and later increasingly to electronics. There's Alfred Goldsmith, a well-known person within IEEE, even for his efforts in IRE. So let's talk about their badge. The IRE adapted an emblem which shows a representation of electric and magnetic forces with a right-hand rule convention, the letters IR and E, and of course forming a triangular badge. The structure of IRE was somewhat intended to be different, and this might have been one of the reasons why IRE was not really dead set on becoming part of AIEEE. IRE people thought of AIEEE as being very centrally controlled, and it was an American institute, where the IRE wanted to be more decentralized, and also they wanted to be a welcome to all engineers around the world, as opposed to just really only American engineers. So they basically wanted to initiate an international organization from the beginning. The proceedings was issued in 1913 to disseminate technical information to its members, and they eventually got around to organizing regional and professional groups in 1914 and 1948, respectively. So in many ways, AIEEE and IRE served their members and their professions. They served them with get-togethers. I mean, I always think that every engineer that joins one of these organizations wants to do three things. It wants to learn something. It wants to maybe help others learn by they can impart information. And they want to network. And that was what both of these institutes did, and did it very effectively. However, the idea that there should be one organization for all electrical engineers was an old one, and became more powerful, and the profession expanded beyond its roots in power and in radio. In 1962, the boards and memberships of the two organizations agreed to merge, and on January 1, 1963, the IEEE, or the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, was born with 150,000 members. 140,000 of them were in the U.S. I should mention here, though, that the membership growth in AIEEE was positive, but it was very slightly positive. But for IRE, it was very positive. There was a high amount of interest in people joining IRE. Electronics was at a booming time, and this is where people could get information and they could network with others. In fact, IRE membership numbers had passed those of the numbers of AIEEE by that time. And also, AIEEE was struggling financially, while the IRE was financially very strong. So we needed a new badge. The new badge for the IEEE contained the kite outlined from the AIEEE and the two vectors representing the right-hand rule from the IRE. The badge had no letters on it. And I guess it was thought that the badge would become so ubiquitously identifiable that they didn't have to put the letters, but it was actually just going to be noticeable and known at that point. So how has the IEEE really done over the years? Well, they've grown quite significantly, as you can see from the numbers, and I hate to do this. It looks like a bit of an eye chart, and hopefully when you get your copies, you can blow it up a little bit now, but it's been a uniform growth. You could see probably that there were times when there was drop-offs and maybe there were recessions or maybe the industries were not hiring as many people as they maybe would be, but there's been a significant growth in the membership of IEEE. So the IEEE was kind of organized, the AIEEE is organized into technical divisions. And the power division was one of them. Initially, the AIEEE power division chose to stay outside of the new IEEE group structure. So I look upon this as being somewhat ironic, at least, because when the IRE was formed, they were not given a warm welcome by the AIEEE. And after AIEEE combined with IRE and the IEEE was formed, the power group was very much afraid that they would be overwhelmed by all the people in communications and in computers, and that the power people wouldn't really get much significantly any influence on the organization. So they started to more or less stay out of the organization, at least initially. They tried to do that. And just to go back into some history of AIEEE, there were publications put out, and they were journals by the AIEEE. There was a part one that had communications and electronics, which also had computing devices in it. Part two was applications in industry. I could make that point that this part two, applications in industry, is now the Industry Applications Society. And then part three was power apparatus and systems. And of course, after IEEE was formed and the power group was formed, they continued with the transactions on power apparatus and systems. And that particular transactions also had sections called new technical activities, research, safety, and standards. So I guess you could say the Power Engineering Society was the precedent. Before them was the power division of the AIEEE. But the term of professional technical groups was more a term out of the IRE. And before the actual groups were formed, they were actually part of the Technical Operations Committee. And there was a power committee within the Technical Operations Group. And one of the first groups that was formed was this PTG-Power. Power Group, as it got to be known, had people within it called the Administrative Committee, and those Administrative Committee people would elect a chairman. So the professional technical group, its purpose was to advance science and practice of electrical generation. Any member of IEEE was able to join it, and they, upon a $6 fee, and at the time IEEE dues were $15, and you could join for $6 and become a member of this new power group. So what were the benefits of joining this group? Well, if you joined the group, you got the transactions on power apparatus and systems. You could attend two general meetings per year. One was in the January-February time frame, and the other was in the July time frame. There were 32 local chapters that you could go to. There was a council of approximately 70 members. So this council met once a year, and it actually elected the officers, the members at large. It approved the constitutional amendments and established policy. Once the administrative committee, which was the ADCOM, was formed with 15 positions reporting to the council, and it meets three times a year, nominates officers and members at large, and approves appointments and approves bylaws. So as you can see, unlike what we do today, in those days, this council, which basically was made up of committee chairs, it was made up of the chapter chairs and many other people, had about 70 members, and all those people then voted in what was the actual governing body. Governing body then selected the persons who were going to be president, vice president, secretary, and treasurer. At the time, the Technical Operations Department had 12 technical committees. So the first five officers of this power group were Charlie Woodrow, Bob Gillette, Tom Marburger, John Lesenyan, and Jack Kinghorn. And as you can see, there was a balance between investor-owned utilities and manufacturers in this group. So what happened after this was the IEEE basically said, we need to form some more galactic kind of groups. And they decided to start out with three societies. One would be a power engineering society, a computer society, and an electronic control society. The IEEE Board of Directors explained that these societies would allow for the merging of closely related or declining groups and would able to bring in non-IEEE groups into the IEEE. I can say from my own experience, since I think there's close to 40 societies now, the idea of a society being a place where there could be the coalescence of similar technologies into one very large society didn't really take hold. That IAS, which are very similar kind of technologies as Power Engineering Society, has stayed within their own societies. In fact, industrial electronics, power electronics, has all been formed as separate societies. So the idea of a society gave a certain amount of, I think, independence to that group to run their own organizations. But they really never became the coalescing groups that they were initially intended to be. 71, the Power Engineering Society Administrative Committee was headed by president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, three operating committees, and some standing committees also, too, that were involved with it. And I think there was a total, that meant that there was a total of, 15 members on the 1971 ADCOM. I just wanted to show the past leaders of Power Engineering Society, not that the names are that important, but as you can see, there was a combination of people from industry that were manufacturers, there were investor-owned utilities, there were public utilities, there were academics, and there was at least one person from a consulting company that also too. And that's gone from 64 now all the way up to 2013. So what are the evolutions, at least that I know some of the ones that I've at least gone through and I've seen since the Power Engineering Society became the Power Engineering Society? And the first thing would be the transition from camera-ready copy to fully edited copy for the journals. The AIEEE had a tradition of making sure that before a paper was published, it would be presented. And the purpose behind that would be that the paper would be presented to an audience of learned people. Those people would then discuss it at the meeting, and they could, if they wanted to, submit a written discussion after that. Then the authors would then look at all the written discussions and send in a closure. And in that way, it was a very convenient way for a person to not only read an article by the authors, see what the discussers said about it, and then see how the authors had closure to it. It was a very, I'd say, ideal kind of way of doing things because it had everything all in one. What we started to find, though, especially in the late 80s, that the general meetings were basically always there to just have a presentation site for all the transactions articles. And if we were accepting somewhere in the order of 6,000 pages per year to be put into the Power Apparatus and Systems, we were probably got about 500 pages in the general meeting in the wintertime and about the same 500 papers in the general meeting in the summertime. So if you had sessions that were five papers per, that would mean that there'd have to be about 100 sessions during the period of the week. And unlike in the probably 60s and 70s, as the 80s went into it and into the 90s, many times the five authors who were presenting the papers might be the only people that were in the room. And it became a very, let's say, inefficient way of using hotel space and presentation locations to have such a small number of people listening actually to the papers. And we also saw that there was very, very few people that were sending in written discussions. Maybe one out of 20 papers would get a written discussion. And, of course, then 19 out of 20 authors never even had to submit any kind of a closure. So what we decided to do is we decided to say, let's not have the presentation before publication as a requirement anymore. And also the transition from camera-ready to fully electronic journals made it easy for us to have an article in one transactions, and if we published the discussions in a later transactions, they could be very easily electronically linked and then also linked with any of the closures. So we decided to then decouple the papers and their discussions. Now, the editorial boards, what I mean by that is the transactions each had editorial boards associated with the subject of the papers. And they were very much tied in with the technical committees. And in fact, usually the vice chairman of each technical committee was the paper coordinator for that committee. And he would then go to whoever was in the committee structure that would be experts in that, say, particular field, say like in power generation and energy development. If a person wrote a paper on adjustable speed drives, he could go to the group, that subcommittee that dealt on adjustable speed drives, and help him to get the paper reviewed. What we eventually thought would be a better way to do this is to have each transaction have its own editorial board. And certainly we wanted to include all of the technical committee people that were knowledgeable in those areas, but then it would also open up others who were knowledgeable in those areas to be part of the editorial boards without having to join the committees themselves. Because the committees themselves were doing a lot of things besides reviewing papers. They were putting out standards. They were putting together discussions at general meetings. The T&D, in fact, had to put together the T&D conference and exhibition. So they had a lot more things that the committees were doing than just reviewing papers. So that if you were a person that was an expert in a specific area and wanted to review papers, what you could just do then is join an editorial board. The next evolution was the PES letters. Many societies within IEEE have letters. And what are letters? Letters are one or two page publications that are usually put out by people doing cutting edge research. They want to put their flag in the sand and say, here's what I'm looking into and here's are my preliminary results. And in fact, a letter should be of transactions quality, but it should have a very rapid turnaround time. And PES didn't have that until a professor, Muhammad El-Hawari, said, you know, Bob, he said to me, we ought to have the letters. And it took some time, but we finally got our letters journal. First, it was published in the PE Review, and then later on, it was published in the subject area of the transactions that the actual letter addressed. Well, the Power Engineering Society had the transactions on power apparatus and systems, and what happened is that was a journal that came out once a month. It was about, it was kind of like a small phone book every month, and what it was found is that it had all of the technical committee reviewed papers in a very, very large variety of areas of specialization. And what we found is we were hearing from people that they would rip out the pages that they thought were good for instrumentation and measurement, or they would rip out the articles that they were interested in, maybe power systems relaying, or they were a power system planner at a utility, so they would look at all the power systems engineering papers. And it just seemed like there were too many trees going to waste with all of these pages being sent to so many people that were not really interested in looking at them all. So we at first said, why don't we take the power apparatus and systems and split it into three transactions. One would be energy conversion. That would have the power generation and energy development committee. It would have the what used to be called the rotating machinery committee, electric machine committee, and et cetera. Then we'll have another one called the power systems, and that would have all the power systems papers by far a large number of papers, and then the power delivery. Power delivery would be, well, how does power get delivered? It's got to have the output of the transformer committee, the substation committee, the switchgear committee, the power systems relay committee, and et cetera. And what it meant then is we took this once a month small phone book that came out, changed it into once a quarter, because each one of the new transactions would come out once a quarter. And we also asked the people to subscribe to them and pay for it, because previously the power apparatus and systems was a free benefit of membership. We added new transactions. We have now the smart grid transactions, the sustainable energy transactions. And what we did also, too, is we got away from this ADCOM that was elected by the council, and we went to the direct election of our own officers. So the officers, the president, vice president or president-elect, I guess we have now, secretary and treasurer were going to be directly related by all the members of IEEE. We went into a globalization and a regionalization strategy, and what that meant, several things. We had two, in fact, chapters congresses, and we brought in chapter chairs from around the world. The first one was held in Denver. The second one was held 4 years later in Seattle. And we found that it was probably more important that we do regional ones. And so now we have chapter chairman, chapter maybe vice chairman, get together in a regional, like Region 8, which is Europe and the Mideast and Africa, let them meet together and share their common problems and their common solutions and let them network with each other. If we're going to do Region 10, well, then let all the countries in China and Japan and India and Australia, let them get together. Now, usually in the general meetings on the Sunday of the general meeting, we normally have Regions 1 through 7 get together. It might be somewhat smaller than that, but we found that it was a more economical way of doing it, but highly effective way of doing it also, too. We also wanted to do regionalization. We tried to do a general meeting in Germany in 1996, and although it was a successful meeting, I think for many American engineers, they couldn't get the approval of their companies to get to that meeting, so therefore, our meeting was very popular with the European people and with any of the people who flew in from, well, from Japan, or they flew in from the U.S., or they flew in from South America. We were a little bit worried that this global meeting, though, wouldn't be as popular as a meeting that was held more regionally. We then had a second one in 2000 where we had the general meeting in Singapore. And again, we found that it was highly attended by the local people, but it wasn't really attended by any people outside of Region 10. So since then, we decided we better have meetings that were catering to the needs of the people. So we had a T&D in the U.S. We had general meetings in the U.S. Why don't we have a meeting over in Europe, like a PowerTech? Why don't we have PowerCon over in Region 10? Why don't we have a Latin American T&D so they would be, you know, satisfied with that? Why don't we have an Asia Pacific T&D? And that way, people who are engineers in those specific regions would go to these conferences that would be easier for them to get to, and they'd be able to interact with the manufacturers in their specific regions. And the manufacturers, of course, would be interacting with local engineers that they knew they could possibly sell something to. So our regionalization, we went from a globalization, I guess, to a regionalization because we found it was actually more important. And in order to help us, because, you know, previously we had like four people in the office that were helping us with the transactions. Well, we created an executive office and hired an executive director. And in 1995, that became Mel Oaken, and he expanded the staff a bit to do more than just the transactions processing, but it would help with chapters, it would help with conferences, and it would help wherever help was needed, as according to how the executive committee and the governing board of PES would direct them to do. PES website was developed so that all of the information we had previously been sending out in hard copy, we would now put on a website, and that website could then be a go-to site for people then to download conference registration forms, hotel registration forms, and even to get to see whose papers were being presented at what conferences. And it became a much more economical way of disseminating information to the people who are members. We also came up with a logo, and our first logo came out in 1995. It was then modified when there was a name change, and then it was modernized, and we'll go through that a little bit also, too. We also had a desire to find out, you know, kind of like the Ed Koch question of how are we doing. So we started to form focus groups, and focus groups would be locally. We would have a general meeting. We would invite all the local, say, vice presidents or senior vice presidents of the local industries, utility, manufacturing, maybe dean of engineering or maybe the head of the electrical engineering department come in, and we would basically tell them what we're doing, and then we'd ask them, how can we do it better? What should we stop doing that you don't think is important? What should we do that you think is important that we're not actually really doing? I can tell you from my own personal experience, what I found out is when we gave them an exposition of what we were doing, a lot of eyes woke up. A lot of people said, you guys are doing a lot of the stuff that we didn't know we had a way to get to. So that was a very enlightening part of these focus groups that we went through. So let me say that, so where are we now, basically? And you can see the mission of PES is to become not just the provider, but the leading provider of scientific and engineering information in the electric power and energy field for the betterment of society, preferred professional development source for all of our members. Our dues in 2014 had gotten up to $35, and of course the IEEE dues are regionally based, and they do change, and they change from 146 to 187. So about PES, I think the words have maybe changed, but I think our basic guiding mission and what we want to do and what do we want to provide has pretty much stayed the same. You know, technological developments, provide a forum, develop standards, and a guide for the development and construction of equipment and systems, and educating the members of the industry and the general public. So what does the governing board look like right now? And these, you know, like Miroslav Begovic and Tamir Novosel, Noel Scholz, Chris Root, and Lena Bertling-Gingenberg, they were all elected, as well as Wanda Reeder, who, of course, is now an IEEE board member, but serves on our governing board, and she was elected by the Division 7 membership, which, of course, Division 7 is only the Power and Energy Society. The newly elected director-elect is Al Rotz. Then we have 7 vice presidents, 4 regional representatives. And let me say the regional representatives basically are chapter people who've risen up in their regions, and then they eventually get to serve on the governing board if they're chosen to do that. 4 members at large, and then Pat Ryan, who's our executive director. So what are the vice presidents? What do they cover and what do they do? Well, Frank Lambert is in charge of chapters. Pete Sauer, in charge of education, which is also where the awards department is. Tommy Main is in charge of meetings, so all the T&D meetings and general meetings and all that is under his domain, and he has to make sure all of them have chairman and all of them are meeting their requirements. Membership and image, Henry Louie. New initiatives and outreach, Robin Padmore. Marissa Crow for publications and technical activities. The head of that technical activities, of course, are all the technical committees, is Ken Edwards. Regional reps, we've broken it up so that regions 1 through 7 are 1 board member for that, Arzana Armstrong. Europe, which also is the Middle East and Africa. Latin America, Region 9, which is basically Latin America, Central and South America, including Mexico, Asia and the Pacific, Region 10. And all of these region numbers are IEEE region numbers. They're basically how the worldwide membership is broken up by IEEE. Members at large, members at large can have specific requirements in accordance with the assignments that are given out by the governing board. And you can see we have 3 people, Ted Burse, who's in charge of standards, Smart Grid by C.Y. Cheng, and PS Resource by Louis Nando Ochoa. Jay Geary is without a portfolio. I mean, he's welcome to the meetings. He's welcomed with his input, but right now he doesn't have a specific job to follow up on. The staff, just to mention, Pat Ryan, I mentioned before, is the executive director, and presently that's all of the people who are in the staff right now in Piscataway who help us as volunteers and help other staff members within Piscataway to understand what's going on with PES and help them get things done. PES publications, of course, I think there's been quite a bit of expansion of the PES publications. the Power and Energy magazine, which basically is free to all members. It replaced what we used to call CAP, the Computer Applications in Power, as well as the PE Review. And this is a beautiful magazine. Its editor-in-chief is Mel Elkin, and it's put out once every 2 months, so there's 6 issues a year, and it replaces what we used to put out, which was PE Review was every month, and that magazine was really more like a newsletter. And what we thought basically is all those newsletter items really can be covered better on the web than they can be in sending out this magazine every month. And the Computer Applications in Power came out quarterly, and we felt when we started Power and Energy magazine, which was started in 2003, that Computer Applications in Power were so integrated into Power, it really didn't have to have a separate magazine for it. And that's where Power and Energy satisfies that. IEEE Electrification magazine is a new one that Saifur Rahman is editor-in-chief of, and it comes to you on a freebie basis. Then the transactions, which are all subscribed to for a fee, they can be either electronically accessed, they can be hard copy accessed, or they can be both. Power systems, power delivery, energy conservation, smart grid, and sustainable energy are them. Power PES letters, they, of course, as I mentioned before, are all integrated into the transactions by subject matter that they cover. This new one is the IEEE Power and Energy Technology Systems. It's an open access magazine or actually journal. And what it means is somebody can get their paper published if it's accepted. They will then pay a fee, I think it's $1,350, to get their article that has been accepted. It'll be published, and it then will be free. So this is a different model than the IEEE Standard Explorer model, where if a transactions publishes an article and somebody wants a copy of that article, the someone who wants it pays for it. In the open access paradigm, the person who writes the article provides the money so that there's no net loss of revenue to the IEEE and the PES, mainly the IEEE, and their paper gets out. The e-newsletter update, I'm sure all the members know about that. That comes out on a frequent basis, and it's one that keeps you informed of what's going on. Number of conferences have grown steadily over the last 7 or so years. And that's mainly because we've done a lot more sponsored meetings, a lot more co-sponsored meetings. And what's not even included in that is the technically co-sponsored meetings, which are meetings that we don't have a real say in what the technical content is, but we do say we're going to publicize them and let people know what they are. But you can see that we have a significant number of meetings going on in many different parts of the world, in practically every region throughout the world, and in many different topics. And of course, the smart grid meetings, as you can see, there's one in Uruguay, one in Poland, one in Thailand, and we had one in Washington, D.C. earlier in the year. Very hot topic, and one that we are definitely going to try to continue to cover and make people aware of it. Education services. Well, of course, Education Services has a lot of the Smart Talk meetings. These webinars are also very good. Some of the elementary introduction to power systems and power distribution systems are a big factor that has really gotten us to, I think, not only financially been rewarding to us, but I think it's also reached a very large number of people who I think wanted to see us do this kind of education. Standards, we're credited with 2,300 plus standards. The areas of coverage I'm sure you're aware of, you've probably used them in your work, whether it's a transformer or a battery or grounding standards, they are all within the scope of IEEE standards produced by PES. Right now, we're 536 power and energy standards of the total 1,252, which is 43%. We're 230 active PARs of the 548 active IEEE PARs, which is 42%. And, of course, a PAR is a project authorization request. Well, in 2008, the Power Engineering Society decided to change its name to Power and Energy. It was believed that this really better entailed to people and communicated to people the scope of what the society was trying to fulfill for them. It was also determined the new name would be appropriate and to attract all new participants and the people involved in the electric energy field. First logo? Well, the first logo in July of 92, we adapted a logo, which actually consisted of a globe, and it had longitudinal and latitudinal lines, the words PES on it, Power Engineering Society across the top, and IEEE along the bottom. I couldn't get a copy of that, but the interim one, of course, when we changed our name, this is what it looked like when they put Power and Energy Society on it. The previous one just had, instead of Power and Energy, it had Power Engineering Society on it. And this is the present logo. I guess it's been kind of modernized and looks a little slicker, but that's the way that it looks. And last but not least, I want to make some acknowledgments. Number one, I read this book, Engineers and Electrons, by John Ryder and Donald Fink. And very, very interesting. If you want to delve some more into it, you can buy this. You can buy it from the IEEE Press. You can buy it from Amazon. It's relatively inexpensive. If you have access to IEEE Explore, you can download it. I can tell you, though, when you download it, you're then going to have to print it and buy a binder for it. So I kind of wonder if it might be cheaper if you just buy the book. But it was a very, very interesting book. Mostly it's about the development of technology from the beginning, but then it also talks about AIEE formation, IRE formation, IEEE formation, and it does mention the power group in there several times too. Sheldon Hochheiser is a man who works at the History Center, and he was very valuable in providing info for this presentation. Mel Oken, as I mentioned, editor-in-chief of the Power and Energy magazine, and Pat Ryan helped me also with this presentation. So with that, I'd like to just say I formally come to the end of the presentation that I wanted to make for today. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Thanks for a great presentation. And thank everyone for attending today's webinar. No, I don't think we have any questions for you, Bob.
Okay. I guess I covered everything.
I guess you did. Okay. Thank you again, everyone, for attending. And thank you, Bob, for a great presentation.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.